pick the frame up. When someone does that, I know they don't know what they're doing. We pick our frame up like this, and we turn it. You know why? Queen's higher. She's going to stand out more. If you look this way, you'll never see it. And then if you were looking for edge, a lot of people say, well, you can see. Well, I got cataracts, floaters, and all that other stuff. If you want to see eggs, let me see now. You get a black cone up here. I got some here. Here's one trick that works for everybody. You don't have to have black cone, but I'm using that just to illustrate. Any cone. You want to see it, you're going to look at it, you're going to see eggs. But let's say that's the sun. Get the sun over your shoulder. The sun looks in here. First thing look for, milky looking. You got milk, you got eggs, you got queen. Don't even worry about it. Time is money. This one here, you know what that stuff is? There's lots of ways that you can treat bees. That's walnut shavings from my planter. Walnut oil is a very good miticide. Same thing with cedar. That's why I don't understand people. Oh, there's a cedar, huh? And it's so nice, it's beautiful. That's why grandma put it in the closet. Yeah. Keeps the bugs out. And cedar, when it hits 75 outgasses, there's enough ways to kill your bees without doing other things to them.
So don't use cedar is what you're saying.
If you want to use it, I'll sell you more bees every year. I mean, I'm not trying to sell you nothing. I'm telling you what works and what don't work.
Yeah. You said that was walnut though, right?
Walnut shavings.
And what do you do with it?
You put a little bit, once you get your fire going in your smoker, you put a little bit there and you cover it good with pine straw. It has to be cool. And when you're using pine straw, you can use damp stuff on the top, but if you're using shavings or sawdust, most people don't realize if they're not paying attention, they're a smoker. You blow out one ember. You pay $350 for this breeder queen, and you got somebody comes up here. One spark hits that queen. She's finished. So that's one of the downfalls. This here is just where we... One of my students that allow the... videotape in this program. Hive tool, number one thing you want to do, this is not my hive tool. You see this here? This here's your hive tool?
My neighbors.
Neighbors? Hive tool will do this to you. And you know how that happened? Put this in here. We're walking through the bee yard. And you swing your wrist. I laid it open many years ago. The next thing is this. This is dangerous. Painter pens, they like to spite it here. You're walking through your bee yard and you hit some sweet gum nut, a little balls. Your foot goes down, you hit this vein. I know a beekeeper that half. Once you lay that vein open, there ain't long, you're gonna bleed out. Oh, this is lithium granules. You know what it's for? You can use it yet for heat. Eat it.
For the essential oil.
Water and oil don't mix. This is a product that you can mix with it and it'll mix. I stopped using it because I don't like it. Get a blender. If you put enough air into it, it stays blended. This is part of my organic treatment that I do at the house.
I'll share a little story on the hive tool. I had a hive tool in this hand. And I don't know what I was doing with this hand. There's a bee on my hand stinging me, though. And I went to smack it, and I drove that hive tool right into this finger right here at the crease.
Yeah.
And I just closed my hand because I knew I cut it. And I was squeezing, squeezing, squeezing. Finally, I opened it up, and I went all the way down to the tendon. And I went to the clinic, and she goes, nope, you're down to the tendon. You got to go to the emergency room. And luckily, I didn't cut the tendon. Because Don told me earlier to, when you get a brand new hive tool, scrape it on a rock or a brick or something to dull it. And yeah, if it would have been sharp as it came, it would probably slice right down to the bone.
This, going back to hive tools, this thing will actually, it'll end up killing you. And this thing here, I don't know why people think they need a crowbar. Any of my students will tell you, the majority of the time, my hive tool, I keep in my hand, I use my fingers to pull the frames apart. Yeah. If you have to pry them apart, that says you ain't been in your hive very often. You've got to keep up on this stuff because Nature's not gonna wait. You're not taking a split in that high tree by yourself, they're gonna do it for you.
Hey, Don, I think I saw you said, since you mentioned how being in the highs, you say you recommend every 14 days?
If you wanna keep, it depends. If you don't worry about it, I've run across a lot of people. I want two hives and I don't want no more. Let them swarm. That's their attitude. It's like everybody has a different attitude. And there's a lot of people don't agree with me. Cells. Supersedure cells. Emergency cells. What? A cell is a cell. An egg is an egg. You have three floors here. Chicken sits on that first floor and sits on that egg. She's got been fertilized. It's going to hatch unless it gets chilled. She's up in that second floor. It's the same thing. Bees will move an egg from one point to the hive to another part. I've been doing this a long time, and I learn things constantly. We have students put stuff in hives, and you got a cork in each end, and you pull the cork out of the candy end, let the queen eat her way out. We put frames in the hive with all new foundation. If that queen don't get out and you put a package in there, you're not going to have queen cells, right? Make sense? Mm-hmm. Then how did we have queen cells with a queen? Because a student forgot to take the cork out. And nature, she passed an egg or through the screens, and they made three queen cells. Wow. So when you say, it ain't gonna happen, this ain't gonna happen, I've seen about everything you can see. Mm-hmm. And I keep learning every year. All right, do you see how happy this guy is? Uh-huh. From Raleigh, here's his friend, this is John Miles, one of my students from probably 10 years ago, you probably tell him not much belly. He come over here because he was wearing a bee suit trying to make queens and he was having bad luck. That's what the big smile is. I'm showing him you can touch them. And I get customers at my house, and my students will tell you, a woman is afraid of bees, I reach up and get her hand and put her on the bees. I'll feel her arm, I can feel the impulses. If she's nervous, I can feel it. And I wait and get her calmed down and I'll put her hand in there. Linda Tillman, you'll probably see her picture. We have works. I mean, you might like Linda Tillman. Linda Tillman come, she is master beekeeper of all these different diplomas, and she listens to too many people. She come up and bought four packages from me, and then called me back about a week and a half later and says, your queens ain't no good. I said, bring the queens back. I'll give you a new one. Not a problem. So things happen. Mm-hmm. Dog can't do that. Why can't you do that? I can't pick it up. Take two spoons, bring it to me. You don't trust me? I said, no. The queen's worth $30. A dead queen's worth $40. Mm-hmm. It's queen lure. So she had a few words and then she runs all this stuff by me. And she says, I could tell those queens was no good. How'd you do that? I held the package up and I looked at it and I said, I knew there was bad queen in there, but I bought it anyhow. She pushed the wrong button that day and I went to listen. I said, don't come in my yard no more. Don't buy no more bees from me. I've been doing bees for many years. I have never yet seen a queen in a cage and tell you how good she is. You have to look at the brood. So that's why I try to tell people, you love me or you hate me. I step on a lot of people's toes. I put out there what is common sense. If I tell you, do this, do that, if you don't question me, or you're just following me around, you ain't learned a thing. That's why I have a learning yard. I want you to come to my yard, I want you to make mistakes, I'm going to watch your work. I might say, do this a little different, try to do it. If you don't make a mistake in my bee yard, you ain't learned a thing. All you're doing is copying. Then when you get to your house, you don't know what you're doing. But these two fellas here, he's running a full-time job over there. He's making about 500 queens a week, part-time. And this is his partner here. All right, let's go to the next one. Oh, see these here? We got a good deal on labels. And we stopped using labels. So what we was doing is labeling everybody's hive that this belongs to this person. And if you sold 10 nukes to somebody, you got 15 red. You put your name. And that might be why he's smiling. was a pink mark and hit with his name on it. So we stopped, we used blue and pink that year. Got into the next one. There's Lynn Tillman. We was buddy buddy for a while. Everybody recognize her? All right, this was the backyard, but I guess it looked like we had a battle. I think we went through and pulled up. This year were changeouts and stuff was going on. And you know what a changeout is? A changeout, you have to maintain a hive. Basically, what we call a changeout is you take another box, if this is your original box, set it on the ground or put a box underneath it so you don't have to bend over. Put a new one in this hive, in this place. Put your entrance reducer in there and start from the outside. Frame by frame, pick it up. What you're doing is changing the hive out. The beetles are gonna end up going to the corners. Check it out, make sure you got no beetles. Put it into the other box. This box will be your original, the new box will be up here. And if you find a queen when you're transferring, and if you see a queen cell, it's got two queen cells, may as well. Go through that, and here's another frame, a couple cells. Put the whole frame in there, because most of you don't have enough equipment. If this hive was ready to split, you would probably need 5 or maybe 8 boxes right now. So that is what we call a change out. And that's what basically is going by here. The equipment looks shabby, I understand that, but time costs money. We, right now, well, you can see the back of my truck, we came from a bee yard the other day. This stuff goes to the home yard, gets painted, new stuff, so it goes out. We have people coming from different magazines and videotape all the time. I go to the next one. All right, see, there's a frame. What do you see on that there? I don't see bees. Yeah, but you don't see a tremendous amount of bees. The hive is healthy. We're making, these are all 5-frame boxes. You've got your pollen here, a little bit of honey, and there's not excessive amount of honey. But what I judge a breeder queen is you should have brood basically from here to here. I like to see 1 to 2 rows of honey. And I want across here with honey. I want bees all the way down here. That's what I consider a breeder queen. In all the years, I've never found solid brood that'll miss a spot here and there. I don't know what nature does. This is where we either cut a cell out or it's communication. Now, I chat with people all around the world, and we was talking about this thing about 8 years ago, old German guy. And he said, you know why hives are dying? I said, no, communication. I said, what are you talking about? Put this in that box. How do these bees communicate from one side of the hive to the other? That's why Dadan, 15 years ago, started putting circles here. The old German knew it. No. Everything that we do is trial and error. We don't use this. If that's what you want to use, this costs you money. Bees are gonna, this is gonna outgas. If you had a frame like this, it had 2 or 3 queen cells, that's only 1 queen cell you can save. Put the whole thing. That's why we do our queen tests.
Why is there only 1 you can save?
I have never been that good to cut it up. I have never been able to do it. You can't see what's on the back, and if you damage that queen cell, just dent it, it don't seem to want to hatch.
Yeah, I did a few of them. I got the plastic, and I couldn't ever get one to hatch.
That's why if you've got several queen castles, this is good for a queen castle, because you can do 4. I mean, if you go through one hive, you've got 4 frames,
yeah,
you can make 4, because you've got a queen here coming out, 1 here, 1 here, and 1 this side.
Yeah.
It should, see, when you get to that point, and you're making queens, I heard someone ask, how do you know about your, when to graft and when not to, how old it is, that you can tell. We can tell, some of my students, usually within an hour, Nikki can tell about an hour. Once you work with them enough, you can learn. But we did a timing box, which is divided. It's got a hole here, it's got a hole here. It's got a queen exploder vertically here and 1 here. I know I'm jumping around a lot, but I'm trying to cover a lot of stuff in a short period of time. The queen timing box is so that you can graft 100 or 500 eggs, and they're all going to come out within an hour or two. So what you do, you want to graft, let's say you want to graft, Wednesday's going to be a good day for you to graft. You've got, this will be over here, this will be over here. Now you've got a queen excluder here, and you've got the queen right here. You come on Sunday, pull this frame out from over here, put this frame over here. Change your layers, just like that. See how easy that is? That's on Sunday. Now you come back on Wednesday, you can either put a mark here, we use thumbtacks, pull that out. Everything that's on that, that hasn't hatched or at different stages, is going to be the right age. That's why we call it timing. This is way ahead of everybody. You've heard about that process, haven't you? I mean, that's, I'm trying to make everything simple. Go to the next
one. So Don, what do you use if you're not using plastic? Are you using no foundation at all, or beeswax, or what?
Wax.
Starters.
Okay. I'm not here to say you beeswax. I'm not here to say you not. I'm here to educate you. If you want to find the queen, quickest way to find the queen, take that frame out, make a split. Take a frame with just the starter strip, drop it in here. Go back in 3 days. Where do you think the queen's going to be? On the new wax. They prefer new wax. That goes contrary to say, save your wax from year to year. It's so valuable. Why do they do this? Because they want clean wax. That wax is the cleanest that you're going to find. I can't guarantee how clean it is, but I know there's no chemical. There's no Kumafos in there, there's no Alphastan, there's nothing Amatrex in it. If you buy beeswax from any bead supplier, it has chemical in it. I don't care what they tell you. They had an article 5 years ago, because they was buying it by the tonnage out of China. If you don't make your own beeswax, you're not going to have clean wax. I can't guarantee where my bees been, but we don't put anything in a hive. We treat naturally. Linda Tillman. That's the first time. She's always wears gloves. That's, I grabbed her hand. See how tight I got it? I made her touch the bees. She was standing from here to there, and she wanted to see the queen. I said, come on over here. And I held it down low. She couldn't see it. And she got close to it like this. I grabbed her hand. I said, touch the bees. I wear gloves. I can't do that. Wouldn't, couldn't, can't. Yeah. That's an example of the bees. They're not stainless bees. They can understand what's going on. All right, do the next one. See, there's probably one of my students did a close-up of her hand. You see, this is one of the outer frames. Now, you see the honey? Look at the honey. This was a frame that has an... We pull that frame there to show her. We run, if you have a strong hive, you're not gonna have a beetle problem. How do you have a strong hive with one and two frames? I'm doing everything wrong. You see my yard? I'm under the pine trees. No sun, a lot of shade. I'm doing everything wrong. Here's the frame that you're gonna find beetles on first, and it wasn't shook up. Pollen frames are the frame you're going to find your beetles first. If you have a hive with nothing but honey, you're going to have a low amount of beetles. You put a pollen patty in there, you open the barbecue, but grill up, they're all going to come. That's why we don't feed pollen substitute. All right, here's the next one. Now, you see this? There's the beekeeper. He was hiding behind the tree. He didn't want to be around the bees. Finally, I got a hold of him. But this is a lot of women work bees up my yard like that. Whatever you feel comfortable with. But you know, it's like what I charge for a package of bees, what the guy down the road charges, no matter what. If you're looking for cheap, you can find cheap. If you want to come and work bees, by a little bit better genetics. That's why if a person comes and they say, I've got Don stock, they can't make enough bees. If they ain't selling bees, then they're sick or they're sleeping all day long. The proof is always in the pudding. Five ring box don't make honey. Look at that crap in there. And what we have to do is pull it out. And we'll set it in a robbing box. which is a five grain box with a solid bottom, let them rub it out. I mean, you either feed sugar or feed honey. I feed a lot of honey back. I did. And see this one here? If you know the symbols of what's going on, that tells you. If you have a hive that has a queen, it's going to be gentle. That don't have a queen. It's going to be a little rough, right? Mm-hmm. She said it wasn't. All right. That's another one, I guess.
So you used to do the three broke bricks for no queen? Is that what you're talking about?
That's got queen cells to cut.
Got queen cells to cut, okay. Mm-hmm.
All right, do the next one. You got to have a method. Now see, I'm talking her husband. He only wanted at a distance. All right, do the next one. See, she says, come on. So he finally got behind her. It takes him a while. All right, take the next one. But he's getting brave now. And then the expression on people's face that they're afraid is so much, and then all of a sudden they're so happy. It's like they got a Christmas present. You see this here? The bird comb on the bottom of that is because of improper space. Mm-hmm. I do it purposely because, like I was saying, if it get bird boogered up here or on this side here, we shade it. And this here, we have a little higher, we have a deeper frame rest, and that's given that. That, to me, that's gold. So, one person it might aggravate. Scraping frames, I used to do it for years. Get hive to scrape them, throw them in the ground. You step on that propolis, it's going to go in the house. And wife don't like it. And if you carry your hive tool in the back pocket, make sure you rub it on a box or something and get it good clean. Because if you stick that hive tool in your pocket and it's got propolis on it, and your wife washes your clothes with hers, you're going to have an unhappy lady. Because sometimes the your stuff gets put in, and maybe she got her bra or pants or something in there, and it gets inside of her clothes, and it doesn't come out. It's like the carpet. You almost have to replace carpet. Now you see, this here is probably May. We do everything at our yard by students. If there's no students, we'll throw boxes on it, because it's a learning yard. Mm-hmm. And I love students to say, well, how do you get the honey out of here? Let's go in the back, I'll show you. And I let them run the extractor. You want a bottle? There's the jars. There's the buckets. Put it in. You pay me just like you would Tom Sawyer. You're going to do it. You do the next one. I don't know what we're doing. I'm trying to reach across to get something. And you see, I'm in thick coverage most of the time. All right. Now there's a frame that I was explaining to them that we throw extra frames in to test. If this hive, I suspect that there's a bad queen in there, I will either throw a deep in there or I'll throw a medium. If I throw a medium in here, it's a half frame. Now, what do you think happens? You got some half frames over here, don't you? Let's see if I can get one out. Here's one. Okay. Now, if you've got bees for very long, what happens if I do this? They're going to build comb below, right? Mm-hmm. What kind of comb are you going to build?
Wax.
This is a test break. I was probably doing a class out there. If you put a shallow or a medium in a deep box, the bees will draw worker cells from here down. Worker cells. Mm-hmm. Make sense? In a tree, all worker cells. But if they're making all this down in the center of a hive that's, say, gone for months, drone comb, what does that tell you?
Swarm.
Getting ready to swarm. They need the drones for mating. It also tells you the queen is starting to fail. Why would they replace something? Like people come to my place and say, I need a queen. What do you need a queen for? Well, the queen ain't laying. Just because they have a sale downtown on motors, 75%, you drove down there, you're going to put a motor in there? Well, you don't need it. Most times you replace a queen, it's a problem that you're having, not the queen. Some of the best queens I have got for nothing from people. We'll frame them up. Look at this, it's all spotted, queen's failing. Not failing. You know what's happening? Anybody know?
They're running hatched out.
They'll replace them with eggs. They'll be either eggs or capped. And I do this at my bee yard. I give you a test. I'll let you do something. I've had many a beekeeper. We'll work four boxes. And I come up to them. What'd you see in that box? I don't know. What color was the queen?
I don't know.
How much brood was on that frames? Was it all drone? Was it worker cells? How much honey was on that hive? I don't know. Then what are you going to the hive for? Just, you've got to understand. But now, getting back to this. Spotted brood, what's the problem? You've got a good queen. It's a hygienic queen. You got a mite problem. The mites are building up. Bees are doing their job. They're pulling the cells out. When you have a situation like that, I tell people, take that frame with the queen, put it in a nuke box, shake two more frames of bees with it. Set it a few feet away from it. Old bees, they come back. Put a queen cell in there, or on something this size, I would put a mated queen. What do you think happens when you put it over in that nuke box? An all new comb. All of a sudden,
queen's good.
Full patterns. What happened? We didn't change the queen. People want to sell you something, but they don't want to tell you what's happening. That's one of the reasons. All right, go to the next one. These things. People say you don't make honey. That is honey. So I'm trying to teach you to think on your own, not what people tell you. That's most of it. If a person tells you what they're doing and they're a master beekeeper and they got four hives and they lose half of them every year, that's not a master beekeeper. I tell people when they come to my yard, look, I'm dumb, my bees are stupid, they can't read and write, so no point in putting your certificate there. They ain't gonna do it. If you want to impress somebody, get certificates in that. I mean, it probably has a point. If you want to make a living, that paper doesn't do it. I have people come that's got 4 or 5 years of college. What are they coming in on a buster back for? They got all that knowledge? I couldn't imagine. See, he's getting more brave. All right. Now, this was the president of our bee club up in Clarksville. He's done a lot of the video tapes and set up the PowerPoint stuff for me because he was trying to help me because I'm not a very high-tech person. If it wasn't for students, you know, in 1990 and 91, I had students come, well, I guess it was in 90, I had classes going on, and I taught everybody free. You got time, and you can listen to me bore you, I'll tell you all about bees. And I had people say, why aren't you charging? You know what I said? Who's going to pay me? I got a 7th grade education. I don't know. That's where it started. Then, one of my students said, why don't you put this video up on YouTube? What's a YouTube? I don't know. So they started doing that. And then my Facebook is run by my webmaster. It was set up for one of my students that come to me 10, 12 years ago from South Dakota. He said, you need a Facebook. What's the Facebook? I don't have a cell phone. I don't walk in my bee yard with a cell phone. You want to talk to me? Send me a short email or call me. You send me this much of an email, you'll never get an answer. Send me this much, you might get an answer. I don't have time to sit. I'm not a computer person. I do the next one. This man here, right there, he's a president, or used to be the president. He actually started Tri-County Beekeeping Club up there. He's a man who kept bees probably for, I'm going to say at least 5, 6 years. And he got talking to me. He came over to my place and started talking to me. And he had four hives, 4 or 5 hives. And he said he wanted to split and make some numbers. And everybody in the bee yard or the bee club said you can only split once. He come to my house with just what he had. And you know how many hives he had at the end of the year? The first year. Take a guess.
He started with
4. Right? He had almost 100.
What?
I'm not going to put no words in your mouth. Tell her how many you started with.
9.
How many you end up with?
75.